Russia has evolved in a substantial way. Russia at one point was controlled by the Bolsheviks until pretty much the end of the communist empire, the fall of the USSR in 1991. And that was a very pivotal shift. I think Vladimir Putin at that time, as he was coming up later to rise into prominence, maybe around 95, 94, 96, when he got around into office, he pretty much began to shift Russia back to the way Russia has always been. He's a strong Orthodox Christian. He's brought them back to their czar legacy. But to some parts of the world, they think Russia is still this communist place. He knows all the mistakes that communism has made because it couldn't get any worse than what it actually did get to. And he learned from that.
Решение о национализации этой библиотеки было принято советским правительством, первым советским правительством, и членами его являлись примерно на 80-85% евреи. Но они же, руководствуясь ложными идеологическими соображениями, шли тогда на аресты и репрессии и иудеев, и православных, и представителей других конфессий, мусульман. Они всех гребли под одну гребенку. И вот эти идеологические шоры и ложные идеологические установки, они, слава Богу...
Why Hitler hated Jews? You're not gonna believe it. He wrote in his book, the Jews are the bigger threat. Why? Because they are communist. They are anti-God. They are the enemies of God. Well, the Jews that he knew, most of them, that's what they were. And he started to describe how they made the revolution in Russia. And he started to give proofs that the Jews are a big danger to Germany, Bolsheviks. They are the biggest threat to Germany. If we don't kill them now, they'll kill us all. They'll do to us what they did in Russia. That's what he wrote in his book. I never knew it until a few days ago.
Hitler told the Sefer Shelo, Sheyudim em communistim. Em asu et ha-mapecha berusia. Em argu sham 30 million Rusim et kol ha-intelligentsia. Betzura achzarit ve-nora. ואת זה הם רוצים לעשות לכל העולם. הארץ הבאה בתור זה גרמניה. הם הקימו את המפלגה הקומוניסטית והסוציאליסטית הגרמנית, וזה נכון. אם אנחנו לא נתגבר אליהם עכשיו, הם יחסלו אותנו וישחטו גם כאן 20 מיליון איש את כל האינטליגנציה. וכך הם הלכו מארץ לארץ. כשבסופו של דבר האינטליגנטים היחידים, החכמים היחידים, יהיו רק היהודים. והוא חוזר על זה הרבה פעמים, שלא תהיה טעות. והוא צודק.
Because all the people that had the money, that lent the money out, were Jews. He didn't like it. He said no more interest. Why? Because of the high interest that the Jews charged people was so high, it ruined, it destroyed the economy in Germany. They destroyed, just like they destroyed Russia a few years before that, through their communism over there. Jews destroyed Russia. Not Goyim. Jews destroyed. Communism is by Jews. Well, don't let anybody confuse you. You look at history, Karl Marx, all the other Reshaim, they're all Jews. Wicked, but nonetheless Jews. They destroyed Russia, and he wrote in chapter 2 of Mein Kampf, they destroyed Russia, now they wanted, they're destroying Germany, that's why I have to destroy them.
בנה טרוצקי, הוא הקים את היפססק כהבריה, המחלגה היהודית של המפלגה הקומוניסטית. בתמונה של פוליט ביורו הראשון, זה כמו הממשלה ברוסיה, מתוך 13 חברים, 6 יהודים. מי הקים את הקגב? לפני כן קראו לו אין כבודה. יהודים? אם כן, הדברים טובים מפורש. הוא לא שנא את היהודים בגלל שיש להם פאות. הוא לא שנא אותם בגלל שהם שומרים מצוות. בגלל שהם קומוניסטים. והוא כותב כאן בצורה ברורה. היהודים הרסו את הדת ואת האמונה. הם הפיצו בגרמניה את הכפירה באלוקים. את זה הוא כותב כאן. אתם מבינים עכשיו לנו לומדים את זה בית ספר? כי מי כותב את תוכניות הלימודים? אתם שמאלנים. הרסו את כל הערכים. הרעילו את כל הספרות והתיאטרון. מתוך 9 עיתונים גדולים בגרמניה, 7 היו של יהודים.
Who knows the first two laws that Hitler implemented? Hitler, Yimach Shemo V'Zichro, first two laws that Hitler implemented that not only put him in a different status than everybody else for the rest of history, but also made what's called until this day the biggest financial miracle in history. Who knows the first two laws? Before the Nuremberg Laws. Before that, we're talking about years before it. Hitler first comes into power. What's the first two laws? Okay, I'll save you the time. Rule number one. No more pornography. No more homosexuality. None of that garbage. Not allowed. Berlin, in the 30s, in the 20s, was the Sodom and Gomorrah of the day. They were the Las Vegas of the day. They were the Sodom and Gomorrah of the day. Homosexuality, pornography, all the bestiality, all the garbage of the world, that was the capital of the world. He outlawed it. You're no longer allowed, closed all the bars, all the gay clubs, all the production, which were all run by Jewish people, unfortunately. Second rule. What's the second rule? Second rule was, you're not allowed to charge interest. No more interest. Now you would think, why? What does he care about interest? Well, because all the people that had the money, that lent the money out, were Jews. He didn't like it. So he said, no more interest. Why? Because of the high interest that the Jews charged people was so high, it ruined, it destroyed the economy in Germany. They destroyed, just like they destroyed Russia a few years before that, through their communism over there. Jews destroyed Russia. Not Goyim. Jews destroyed. Communism is by Jews. Well, don't let anybody confuse you. You look at history, Karl Marx, all the other Rishayim, they're all Jews. Wicked, but nonetheless Jews. They destroyed Russia, and he wrote in chapter 2 of Mein Kampf, they destroyed Russia, now they're destroying Germany, that's why I have to destroy them. Now, this doesn't make he's right, the point is that's actually real true history. Now, he saw that the Jews are controlling the financial system and they're charging such high...
Communism has been a big deal in this region of Russia and Ukraine for over 100 years now. However, to understand where communism came from, you need to understand the history of the pogroms in the Pale of Settlements region, which began in 1772. The pogroms were violent attacks by white Russians against the Jewish Russians living in the Pale of Settlement region for over a century. And when you look at the committees who started the communist revolutions in Russia in 1905 and 1917, you see the leaders are Ashkenazi Jews, the victims of the pogroms.
Red Army units and the secret police agency set up by Lenin, known as the Cheka, had no compunction about using the most ruthless methods to deal with monarchists and other anti-communists. In telegrams to his militants, Lenin ordered that all those who opposed the communist regime should be shot. The Bolsheviks arrested tens of thousands of people for the crime of opposing the regime. Most of these were tortured and executed en masse. The famous Russian writer Maxim Gorky described examples of Bolshevik savagery. In Tambov province, communists were nailed with railway spikes by their left hand and left foot to trees a meter above the soil. And they watched the torments of these deliberately, oddly crucified people. They would open a prisoner's belly, take out the small intestine, and nailing it to a tree or telegraph pole, they drove the man around the tree with blows, watching the intestine unwinding through the wound. Stripping a captured officer naked, they tore strips of skin from his shoulders in the form of shoulder straps. A terrible fear fell over Russia, but the communist savagery had only just begun.
And so the overthrow of the Russian people and the Ukrainian people by these revolutionaries was carried out by the Khazarian mafia, who were made up mainly of atheists who were Freemasons of the Oriental variety. And so the Oriental Freemasons were the ones behind communism. And they were in it for themselves, not for the poor working classes that they used to have the uprising in St. Petersburg. And they managed to squash all the poor people in Russia under their iron fist.
When the Bolsheviks came to power, most of the population of Russia lived in the villages, enjoying a pretty miserable standard of living. Most peasants were only just able to feed their families with what they produced. The freezing Russian winters made productive agriculture an impossibility. A decision taken by Lenin in 1918 inflicted an even worse disaster on millions of peasants who were already living in poverty. Private property was forbidden, and the peasants' goods were to be confiscated by the state. Lenin carried out that policy by means of another right-hand man, Felix Dzerzhinsky, the head of the Cheka, well known for his ruthlessness. Cheka officers descended on villages all over Russia and began rounding up peasants' crops and livestock at gunpoint. A quota to be handed over by every peasant and given to the Bolsheviks was drawn up. In order to meet that quota, most of them had to give up all that they possessed. Peasants who protested were silenced by the most savage means. On 14 February 1922, one inspector who visited the Omsk region wrote, "Abuses of position by the requisitioning detachments, frankly speaking, have now reached unbelievable levels. Systematically, the peasants who are arrested are all locked up in big, unheated barns. They are then whipped and threatened with execution. Those who have not filled the whole of their quota are bound and forced to run naked all along the main street of the village and then locked up in another unheated hangar." Lenin was enraged when he realized that the quota set for the villages would not be met. In 1920, he inflicted a fearful punishment on some regions that had resisted the requisitions. Not only would these peasants' crops be seized, but also all the seeds they possessed. Confiscating the seeds meant that the peasants would be unable to produce a new crop. In other words, they would have nothing to eat. Then the famine began. 29 million people within the borders of Russia battled with starvation. In 1921 and 1922, 5 million starved agonizingly to death. Lenin watched what was happening with enormous pleasure. In his view, the famine was most useful. He calculated that it would help to destroy people's belief in God and religion and make them bow their heads to communism. In the Black Book of Communism, that sent shockwaves around the world, that devilish idea of Lenin's is discussed thus. As one of his friends later recalled, Vladimir Ilyich Ulyanov had the courage to come out and say openly that famine would have numerous positive results. Famine, he explained, would bring about the next stage more rapidly and usher in socialism, the stage that necessarily followed capitalism. Famine would also destroy faith, not only in the Tsar, but in God too. This is what Lenin wrote to the members of the Politburo on March 19, 1922. The present moment favors us. With the help of all those starving people who are starting to eat each other, who are dying by the millions, and whose bodies litter the roadside all over the country, it is now and only now that we can and therefore must confiscate all church property with all the ruthless energy we can muster. Our only hope is the despair engendered in the masses by the famine, which will cause them to look at us in a favorable light, or, at the very least, with indifference. These communications in the Soviet archives have revealed that Lenin deliberately brought about that dreadful famine which cost 5 million lives. That is the same conclusion arrived at by the historian Richard Pipes, who spent years researching the archives in his book, The Unknown Lenin. In his view, for humankind at large, Lenin had nothing but scorn. Individual human beings held for Lenin almost no interest, and he treated the working class much as a metal worker treated iron ore.
And so historians say that the pogroms cost 100,000 lives, that is 100,000 Jewish lives, there in the Pale of Settlements region over a period of about 3 centuries. And from 1917, we know that the numbers of retribution against the Russian people by the Jews cost millions of lives. This eye for an eye, tooth for tooth attitude that they have meant that they murdered millions and millions of Russians and later Ukrainians. And this is because they have the attitude that non-Jews are the goy, being people who are not the chosen people. And they are like animals in their eyes, and so they treat them like animals.
Not only did Lenin regard human beings as a species of animal, he also employed animal methods to train them. In October 1919, he paid a personal visit to the Russian scientists Ivan Pavlov, famous for his conditioned reflex experiments on animals. Lenin wanted to impose these conditioned reflex methods on the whole of Russian society. Pavlov was astounded. "I want the masses of Russia to follow a communistic pattern of thinking and reacting," Lenin explained. Pavlov was astounded. It seemed that Lenin wanted him to do for humans what he had already done for dogs. "Do you mean that you would like to standardize the population of Russia? Make them all behave in the same way?" he asked. "Exactly," replied Lenin. "Man can be corrected. Man can be made what we want him to be." From 1922 on, an increasingly serious sickness slowly began to paralyze him. He spent most of 1923 in a wheelchair, suffering from terrible headaches. In March 1923, he had a stroke and was thenceforth unable to speak normally. In the final months of his life, those who saw Lenin were terrified. His face had taken on a peculiar expression, and he was half mad. The final photograph taken of him shortly before his death was utterly ghastly. Lenin died on January 21, 1924. The Bolsheviks organized a huge funeral ceremony for Lenin. The leaders of the Communist Party decided to have his body, which had a tremendous importance for them, embalmed. Among those bearing Lenin's coffin was the next dictator of Soviet Russia, Joseph Stalin.
In Moscow, Red China's foreign minister Chou Enlai signs a 30-year treaty with Soviet Russia as dictator Joseph Stalin looks impassively on. The treaty, the result of 2 months' secret negotiation, binds each to aid the other if attacked. Russia's Molotov sees Foreign Minister Baczynski sign. Red China's boss, Mao Zedong, isn't saying what China gave Russia in return for such treaty aid as a $300 million Russian loan.
The great Chinese chairman Mao Zedong once declared the death of 300 million of his own people would be a price worth paying.
He was basically saying, I can lose half of my people to get what I want. I'm ready to take that risk. That's a brutal, callous way of thinking.
Ultimately, his heartless political regime oversees the slaughter of millions.
Violence works, and it works through power. He was convinced that politics had to be violent.
This is the story of a sadistic autocrat addicted to brutality. From his communist roots, through his reign of cruelty and revenge.
Mao was in the league of a Hitler and Stalin.
At 189 Jiefeng North Road in Heping District, Tianjin, stands a small European-styled office block hiding a unique story from China's modern history. In 1886, this now renovated building was once the Tianjin Printing House, home to newspapers such as Peking and Tianjin Times over a century ago. It was there in 1931 that a young 15-year-old Jewish boy from Poland laying the foundations for a successful career in journalism. In the coming years, he would go on to live a remarkable life as a journalist and author, and becoming one of the first naturalized Chinese citizens to become a member of the Communist Party of China. His name was Israel Epstein, or Epi to his friends, and this is his story.
And so how did these evil communist regimes come into power in the 20th century? And the answer to that question is through the Jewish international bankers, who were mainly from Germany, London and New York. And here we see Jacob Schiff, who was a leading partner in the international Jewish banking firm in Wall Street called Kuhn Loeb, who boasted on his deathbed that he provided $20 million towards the success of the Bolshevik Revolution in 1917. And then in 1949, we know that a key Jewish man was a man called Israel Epstein. And here he is in the photograph with Mao Zedong, second from the right on the bottom row. And he's surrounded by Jews there. And also another high-level meeting with Mao is also him being surrounded by Jews. And attending that meeting was Frank Coe, Israel Epstein, Elsie Fairfax Cholmeley, and Solomon Adler. And we also know that another prominent member of the Politburo was the propaganda minister, who was a man called Sidney Shapiro, who was an American Jew. And we see both Sidney Shapiro and also Israel Epstein at Israel Epstein's 90th birthday, being held at the Jingfeng Hotel there in Beijing. And also, you see another photograph here of Israel Epstein with Chairman Hu Jintao. And so we know that the Jews were involved in establishing the revolutions during the 20th century. And also we see also that David Rockefeller is an enthusiastic supporter of China.
We were young, vigorous boys, and 4 years had passed since our last sexual encounter. That's why we caught any German woman who crossed our path. Sometimes 10 Soviets would rape the same girl. There weren't enough women for all of us, and besides, soon the rumor of what we were doing spread, causing people to flee. We had to settle for 12 and 13-year-old girls. When they cried, we covered their mouths with a cloth, something that seemed amusing to us. Now that the years have passed, I don't understand how I was able to do this, I who had been raised by a respectable family. The terrible words you just heard belong to a former soldier of the Soviet Union. In 1945, the Red Army swept through the city of Berlin, drowning it in a wave of death and destruction that left tens of thousands dead. The crimes of the Stalinist troops were forgotten, as historians focused for decades on the abominable crimes of Nazism. And the crucial Soviet victory that ultimately destroyed the Third Reich. However, starting in 1991, with the dissolution of the communist state, declassified documents have revealed shocking information about the actions of the Soviets in the German capital. The testimonies are chilling. Looting, mass rapes, summary executions, desperate soldiers seeking revenge, and officers turning a blind eye to the suffering of German civilians.
Эти повозки, фургоны, машины в кювет. И пока они сбрасывают, солдаты срываются со своих мест и начинают насиловать женщин, немок. И вот мой взвод собственный, все мои солдаты бросаются и насилуют немок. Когда на спасение дети... Матерей пытаются спасти, их застреливают. Их расстреливают, детей. Значит, теперь на дороге стоят генералы, наблюдают это, полковники. Ну, временные, дальше ехать нельзя, была загромождена дорога. Вышли. И телефонистки мои все смеются. Реакция, они матерщиницы все были, телефонистки, да. Я...
The testimony we saw earlier is certainly chilling. There is nothing more terrible than hearing it from the mouth of one of the victims. Now we will listen to Lisa Slater, an administrative employee of the Wehrmacht who was sheltered with others in a basement. One day, they were intercepted by the Soviets, who made them experience hell.
From then on, we lived in the basement, in the basement garden basement. Yes.
The basement of whose house?
My aunt, across from her was Kreuzberg. Beautiful kind of, oh, it was a park. And the caretaker had a huge home there with garden places. And so we moved in there. And that's when I saw my first Russian soldier, we all. The little Mongolian, even we had May, with their fur caps down, okay? And then they came downstairs to the basement, putting this cardboard on the table, telling the people in Berlin, Väterchen Stalin gave his troops the right to rape, to steal, to kill, to do whatever they want to do. And believe me, they did. They came every night into our basement, to all the basements. They just took their boots, and we were all bedded down. All the men in the front, the woman in the back. By then I was in my 9 months pregnancy, also close to having my child. And they kicked with the boot, Frau komm. That's the only German word maybe they knew, Frau komm. And then the person had to get up, the woman, and they didn't take her outside the basement. They put her against the wall, and they stood in line with their machine gun pointing at us and raped the woman. And they were not 18 years or 19 or nobody looked good. I mean, you didn't want to look good. There was a lady, she was in her 60s, and I thought that was old at that time. She had a husband in the basement with her. And I don't know why, that poor woman was almost taken every night. And one night her husband was just so frustrated, he got up and thrust forward and kept saying, no, no, please, no. And what they did, they turned around, shot him, raped her, and after they finished raping her, shot her. And we were not allowed to take these bodies out of the basement for the whole night. We had to leave the bodies in the basement. And then the next day, some official came down, and then we were taken out. And then our man, our old man, told us when they took the bodies out, there were a heap of bodies and everything. That went on in Berlin with the loudspeaker playing Tchaikovsky music on every corner, beautiful music, and in between they tell us, people in Berlin, we make a second Moscow out of you, and the war is over, you will be glorious Russia, and this, but it, and we had women and young children, our young teenagers, jumping literally off bridges, off everything, just to kill themselves, because they didn't want to be raped. And this is what I don't think, ever in my life will forget. My mother, it isn't just that it happened to us or to me. I was so far advanced with my pregnancy. The humiliation that I was even pushed against the wall, even though he was drunk as anyway. They couldn't do anything with me. And I had the gall, I spat at him. But I'm so little and they were so tall, he didn't even know it. But my sister had already her 6 months old child, so she took the safety needle from that dirty diaper what she had on and started poking her daughter in her little behind so she would scream and scream and scream. And that maybe saved me that they finally decided to leave and scan out of there. These are things what maybe are not said.
After their passage through the city of Berlin, they left a trail of blood in their wake and ruined the lives of thousands of innocent people. Among them were women who were savagely raped and, in the following years, had to deal with the psychological consequences of trauma. Many became pregnant after the assaults and were marginalized by the Germans themselves, who saw them as collaborators of the communist troops.
The women of Berlin were being treated as spoils of war, who the soldiers took their anger out and rage on. Many women were forced to try and become friendly with one Soviet soldier, so they would protect them from other members of the Red Army. For example, Magda Wiedland, a 24-year-old actress, was dragged from a cupboard where she hid, and a soldier from Central Asia found her. She offered to be his girlfriend if he would protect her from other Russians, but instead he boasted to his friends, then they assaulted her en masse. Many women had to disappear during what they deemed was the hunting hours, where the Soviets would look for any women. They saw the safer hours as the early morning, when they were hung over and sleeping, and many mothers gave themselves up to save their daughters. Many women who live in Berlin today can still recall the horror and the screams of those nights, and as many of the windows had been blown out through the artillery, everything could be heard. The city's hospitals had to deal with many victims of the Red Army, and one doctor believed that around 100,000 women had been assaulted in Berlin, but 10,000 women had died from their ordeals, or the fact they took their lives after the horror they were subjected to. It's believed that 2 million women at least were assaulted by Red Army soldiers across Germany. Men who tried to defend women against Soviet attackers were shot dead and were killed and executed in brutal ways. Following the fall of the city, onlookers noted that out of desperation and for food, many of Berlin's women sold themselves for food and other luxuries such as cigarettes, which were being used inside the city as currency. One woman.
The most harrowing aspect of the Red Army's occupation of Berlin was the widespread sexual violence perpetrated against German women. Estimates suggest that up to 2 million German women were sexually assaulted by Soviet soldiers during this period. In Berlin alone, it is believed that around 100,000 women were assaulted, with many of them subjected to repeated offences. Some women were assaulted as many as 60 to 70 times, illustrating the extreme brutality of these acts. Years.
That's how the history of the ethnic German cleansing has been dealt with.
The survivors' stories will pay homage to the 15 million people who felt it, lived it, and the many who died from it.
The forgotten genocide will now be remembered.
Then the air raid siren wails again to remind them that they lost a war of their own making. To remind them that it is up to them to regain their self-respect as a nation and to learn to live in a friendly manner with their neighbors. To remind them that much as we hate it, we shall stay in Germany until we have real guarantees that the next generation will grow up a sane and Christian people. A Germany of light and life and freedom. A Germany that respects truth and tolerance and justice.
Tell me what is Yagoda and what happened with the Bolsheviks and the Christians?
oh, you just casually killed 10 million Christians. It's incredible. People think that the greatest mass murderer was Adolf Hitler. And it, no, actually, if you want to talk about genocide, the fact that people in America don't know about what the Bolsheviks did to Christians, where did the idea of a concentration camp come from? The Bolsheviks. The reason why we're not allowed to learn about these people, we don't talk about Henry Gagoda, is because he's a Jew, right? And so it conflicts with the narrative of Jewish people always being the victim in every single circumstance. So we're willing to push away Christian history. We don't talk about Christian history whatsoever because they have this bizarre focus, our classrooms, on training us to have this bizarre allegiance to Israel. And so to suit us, I feel that we are heavily propagandized in the classroom. And the reason why I feel that way is because we spend years talking about the Holocaust, only for me to learn when I'm out of school about a bigger Holocaust that took place at the exact same time. We were locking arms with Stalin. I mean, you read Alexander Solzhenitsyn talking about the gulags and who built those gulag systems, who created those gulag systems. The majority of them, he eventually wrote a book, were Jewish men. And of course, this has not become collective guilt. Doesn't mean all Jews are Bolsheviks and think this way. But the fact that I'm denied the right to talk about my history while you demand I talk about yours and you demand that I worship Israel doesn't fly with me. I'm just sick and tired of the subjugated Christian. I'm sick and tired of the tail in between your leg Christian that is like Israel first, and then I'll get to the New Testament. You know, it doesn't make any sense to me. I'm uncomfortable with it. And that was probably the first time in that entire interview that Piers shut up because he knows I'm right. It's utterly ridiculous to come to a Christian and say, have you used your platform to talk about Israel? Do you think that he would go to a Jewish person and say, have you used your platform to talk about Armenia? And if the answer is no, then why not? It's because what has happened is that it's not an equal system. No, it's not equality. They are treated, Israel as a country is treated with special interests. And I gotta say about Israel, just looking at the history there, I mean, this is our greatest ally, as they say, that's the program. This is our greatest ally. I mean, with allies like that, who needs enemies, right? In terms of the things that they have been involved in historically, no, I wanna talk about the USS Liberty. With allies like this, who needs enemies? I am tired of being involved in their crap. I'm America first. I won't apologize for it. I'm Christianity first. I won't apologize for it. And that upsets some people because I guess, how dare she have the audacity? Well, guess what? I have the audacity, folks.
So you're saying that there was a greater Holocaust of Christians that happened, and yep, it was committed by the Bolsheviks, and the leader of them at the time was a Jewish guy.
Well, Henry Gagoda, what really ran the gulag camp system. So people should read, if you're interested, Alexander Solzhenitsyn talking about how shocking it was to watch the American president linking arms with Stalin, talking about we're putting an end to the Holocaust in World War II, and Stalin was still mass killing Christians.
Was wir unter Ideen und Weltanschauung im Allgemeinen zu verstehen pflegen, hat mit dem, was man Bolschewismus nennt, gar nicht zu tun. Es handelt sich bei ihm um einen pathologischen, verbrecherischen Wahnsinn, nachweisbar von Juden erdacht und von Juden geführt, mit dem Ziel der Vernichtung der europäischen Kulturvölker und der Aufrichtung einer internationalen jüdischen Weltherrschaft über sie. Die Einzelheiten, die über die Ermordung von Priestern und Schändung von Nonnen an uns gelangen, sind ganz unvorstellbar und deshalb auch gar nicht wiederzugeben.
Denn diese selben Staatsmänner, die sich still, als in Russland Hunderttausende am Vermessen oder verbrannt worden waren, die liegen still, als in Spanien Zehntausende von Priestern und Nonnen in vielster Weise abgeschlachtet oder bei lebendem Leib dem Feuer übergeben wurden. Die konnten und können diese Tatsachen nicht bestreiten.
Dann er ist sanne Gott i forbund med djevelen. Han er Gott i forbund med bolsjevismen. Med bolsjevismen, hvis mål er å utrydde og ødelegge all europeisk kultur. Ødelegge alt det som vi setter pris på i livet. Alt det som for oss er hellig. Hjem, familie, ektefelle og barn, moral, kristendom. Alt det vil bolsjevismen ødelegge. Og med det går de i forbund. Men det slutter Churchill forbund for å ødelegge nasjonale reisninger i Europa, ødelegge det nasjonale Norge.
England kjemper ikke engang for England. Englands ledende menn lar jo England gå til grunne. England kjemper kun for den internasjonale klikk, for plutokratene, jødene, for frimurene.
Udakke det,
dieses Teufelspriester, der Mensch, dass ein Raum vom Bolschewismus ist, wird nicht in Erfüllung gehen, sondern dass die Beten in Erfüllung gehen. Herr Gott, gib uns die Kraft, dass wir uns die Freiheit erhalten, unserem Volk, unseren Kindern und unseren. Nicht nur den Deutschen, sondern auch den anderen Völkern Europas. Denn es ist nicht ein Krieg, wenn wir alle dieses Mal führen. Wir würden das deutsche Volk ein. Es ist ein Krieg für ganz Europa und damit wirklich für die ganze Menschheit.
Der Völkerstreit und Hass untereinander, er wird gepflegt von ganz bestimmten Interessenten. Es ist eine kleine, wurzellose, internationale Clique, die die Völker gegeneinander hetzt, die nicht will, dass sie zur Ruhe kommen. Es sind das die Menschen, die überall und nirgends zu Hause sind, die nirgends einen Boden haben, auf den sie gewachsen sind, sondern die heute in Berlin leben, morgen genauso gut in Brüssel sein können, übermorgen in Paris und dann wieder in Prag oder in Wien oder in London und die sich überall zu Hause fühlen. Es sind die Einzigen, die wirklich als internationale Elemente anzusprechen sind, weil sie überall ihre Geschäfte betätigen können.
Wir müssen an Bolschewiken eine Sanktion treffen und jagen Millionen an dem mit uns. War in 1932 mit 33 Günther Stalin bewiss 6 Millionen Bönder zu töten. Die sabotierende Presse, die Ukraine von Bolschewismen, grübeln kennt ihr nicht. Wenn sie erhofft hat, wird Post auf Nationalsozialistisch gehen kann. Nationalsozialismen, von Bogar rettet, liegt von den Opretonen und unterstützen die christliche Kirche in Deutschland. Und über die Färbe und Jenreise, Kirchenwehr in Russland, vor Bolschewiken hat er sehr von den Kirchenhüten und ich bedeutet den Kindern.
Since they first appeared in the 18th century, Freemasons have provoked speculation and aroused fantasy in Europe and across the globe. With their enigmatic symbols, secret rituals, and supposed influence in the political and economic world, no other organization has generated as much fascination and hostility.
They say that Freemasonry is secretive, but no, it's discreet.
With World War II, this hostility came to a head. Convinced that the Freemasons held political and esoteric secrets, the Nazis launched mass robberies of European Masonic lodges in occupied countries.
Were there esoteric documents in these archives? Yes.
To have possession of the secret archives of the Freemasons was to fight from within to destroy their influence.
It's the largest collection of Masonic archives that's ever been brought together in the world.
From the very beginning of Nazi occupation, the French lodges were occupied by German military police.
Dieser Logentempel wurde von unseren Truppen in Paris entdeckt. Die internationalen Freimaurer umgaben sich auch hier mit kindischer Symbolik und albernem Prunk. Hinter dieser Tarnung verbargen sie jene großen politischen und wirtschaftlichen Transaktionen, die einer kleinen Clique von Plutokraten, Finanz- und Waffenschiebern riesige Gewinne verschafften, ganze Völker aber den Elend preisgaben.
Lavrenti Beria, nicknamed the Russian Himmler, the man behind the torture and deportations of any and all who challenged communism.
So it was about a week later that I was given permission to go back in the stacks and see more of these files. I found a top secret folder about the seizure by Smersh, the Soviet counter-espionage group. Beria had sent instructions for a special team to go to a small village in the Sudetenland. This was in May 1945. They brought 28 freight car train wagons, sealed, of course, of French archives.
The countries that had fallen victim to the Nazis were shaken to the core by these findings, as they discovered that whole sections of their collective memory had landed in the hands of the Russians. The Freemasons were alerted.
As soon as I had confirmation that Masonic archives existed somewhere in Moscow, I organized a special group. They discovered that there were roughly 28,000 files. The boxes were numbered and well organized, as you can imagine would be the case of the Soviet administration of the time.
Gotcha.
And something I wanted to point out to you, you know, there are many pictures about the Russian liberating Auschwitz, and there's never any snow. And the snow was honestly that high. Mm-hmm. And so I have some connection with the Russian embassy, and I was there once, and I said, something puzzles me. Those photos are fakes, because there's no snow. Mm-hmm. And they said, well, yes, they are not fakes, but when the army came, they didn't have cameras, they didn't photograph. Mm. So only much later, when they realized we should have pictures of it, they took pictures, right, like you see now. But this is definitely not in Auschwitz and not the liberation of Auschwitz. There were not that many people with clothes and children and no snow.
Right, fascinating.
So I think historically we should point this out.
And get it right, yeah.
To get it right.
أغلبنا لا يعرف بأن صعود النازية بين الحرب العالمية الأولى والثانية هو كان بدعم أمريكي. الكل يتساءل طيب كيف كان هناك يعني انهيار ألماني وقيود أوروبية، كيف سمحوا للنازية بالصعود وتأسيس جيش بالدعم الأمريكي بالأموال الأمريكية بالقروض بالاستثمار؟
Here's a little song I wrote. You might want to hear it in your pot. You'll owe nothing and be happy. Ain't got no cash, ain't got no car, but 24 booster shots in your arm. Owe nothing, be happy. You can't even buy shit in the store because of your low social credit score. Oh, nothing. Be happy. You'll owe nothing and be happy. Be happy and eat the bugs.
6 million. لا يوجد أي دليل بأن هناك 6 million يهودي قتلوا. وربما حصلت محارق لا أحد ينفيها وهناك معسكرات اعتقال صحيح، ولكن الدليل على أن هذا الموضوع مسيس وليس إنساني ولا حقيقي، كيف نتحدث عن 6 million ولا نتحدث عن 26 مليون سوفيتي قتلوا في تلك الحرب؟ يعني 6 million أغلى. الممارسات نفسها كانت على كل الاتجاهات، لم يكن هناك طرق قتل مختصة باليهود ولا طريقة تعذيب مختصة باليهود، في كل الأماكن نفس الطريقة استخدمتها النازية، ولكن القضية هي قضية مسيسة ولتزوير الحقيقة ولاحقا للتمهيد لنقل اليهود من أوروبا باتجاه مناطق أخرى هي فلسطين. اليهود الذين أتوا إلى فلسطين هم يهود الخزر شرق قزوين، هم وثنيون و تبعوا الديانة اليهودية في القرن 8 الميلادي، هاجروا إلى أوروبا وأتوا إلى هذه المنطقة، لا يوجد أي علاقة بينهم وبين شعب إسرائيل.
Hey guys, if you want to watch more clips, click here.
And if you want to watch the full podcast, click right here.